This is Caden Prescorn.
This is JJP Gies.
Hey everybody, this is Jackson Dart, Ole Miss quarterback. You're listening to the Red and Blue Crew with Dave and Brad.
Welcome to the Red and Blue Crew podcast, the source for all Ole Miss sports news, rumors, and innuendo. Are you ready? From the inside the Rebels studios, let's get ready to rumble. Now here are your hosts, David Johnson and Brad Logan.
And hello, everyone. Welcome in the Red and Blue Crew podcast. Brad Logan alongside David Johnson today. And David, it's funny. We've got the Grobo games upcoming. We've got recruiting is wide open. We'll talk about a big commitment on the offensive side of the ball. The transfer portal. We think there's probably a couple of running backs, maybe one, maybe two coming in. A lot going on. Baseball's in full swing. Women's basketball just finished up a huge year. The women's basketball game across the country is wide open. And oh, by the way, it's the off season.
Yeah, and Brad, you didn't mention the softball team and all of that.
That's not going too well at softball, but we can delve into that. But they've seen better days. They need to turn some things around. But yeah, a lot of things happening on campus. And it's the off season for football, but yeah, just it's everything is what I was thinking about early this morning when I woke up. Is it is legitimately 365 days a year when it talks about Ole Miss football, because you've got the recruiting, you've got obviously the season, then the off season with all of the training and the spring practice. It's just, boy, it just never stops.
No, it doesn't. And the transfer portal opens back up for the spring session on Monday, which is a tax day, by the way. Not that that's a good thing, but so we're going to have 2 weeks worth of frenziness on the recruiting front. And we all expect Ole Miss to bring in at least one running back, maybe two running backs, Brad. And some candidates are starting to emerge. Number one is Henry Parrish from Miami. We all feel like Parrish is going to be back in the red and blue. And then if they take a second back, and I think they will, who will that be? That's the million-dollar question right now. And then where else might they look for some help? I don't think it's going to be a quarterback this year. They don't need any wide receiver help. They've got some more help on the way with Deion Smith and Marquise Willis, both set to arrive at the end of May. The O-line is honestly, I think it's stocked. They got a companion tight end for Caden Prescorn in Daquan Wright. So you figure they'll probably, if there's a great defender anywhere in the portal, I could see Ole Miss kind of zoning in on that guy. So running backs, maybe a guy or two on defense. I think that's it. I really do.
The defense and the offense have set up really nice, and I'm excited to see this weekend. And David, I'll be honest, I've read the transcripts or the releases. We know that coolers are going to be open for students to bring in. They have to leave them in the student section, and they can be full of their favorite beverage of choice. So there's some changes going on. I think Juice Giffen will be involved, and they're calling it the Grove Bowl games. We'll probably see Juice on the Jumbotron. We'll see Lane and some of the offensive players. And we saw an interview with Lane and the offense and defensive captains, I think. I think it was Jackson Dart. I forget who the other one was. And they were just kind of talking about the different teams and the different things that we're going to be seeing. I just frankly don't know a lot about what we're going to see. I'm mainly just going to be looking who's out there, who's not out there, rather than the actual games in and of itself. What do you kind of – looking for or thinking about when we're talking about the Grobo games this weekend on Saturday?
Yeah, which recruits are on the sideline?
Yeah.
I mean, to be honest with you, from a football standpoint, you're not going to learn much about this team, and it's designed to be that way. I may stat how many touchdowns Juice Kiffin runs for, but my focus is on the recruits on Saturday. who all's here. And, you know, all the quarterbacks are going to throw for, you know, 8,000 yards and 20 touchdowns in this thing. But do I blame Lane for doing it this way? Not at all. Not at all. You keep the veil over this bombshell of a football team that we all think you have for as long as you possibly can. And you don't get anybody hurt. You don't show anything. Don't get anybody hurt. And then, you know, if those two things come together and there isn't a riot in the student section with all the alcohol, you've had a successful day.
Speaking of recruiting, how many recruits do you expect on Saturday?
Don't know yet. You know, there's also a big Under Armour camp up in Nashville going on the same day. So, you know, I would think that'll affect it a little bit. But, you know, generally speaking, look, it's a spring game. I think you're talking about minimum 100 kids. You know, they're going to bring in kids from the 28 class all the way through the 25 class. And I think that's what you're looking for.
In your opinion, you've covered recruiting for years and years and years. This year, it feels like you're doing a ton of recruiting coverage because you've got a lot of help doing some other things in football. How is recruiting doing for the 25 class? I know we just saw a commitment recently from a wide receiver that originally grew up in Goshen, is now in Alabama. But in your opinion, how's recruiting going for that 25 class?
No, I think it's going great. They're recruiting like they should be as an elite college football program. and I'm not just blowing smoke with that. I mean, you look at the visit list today, Stephon Shivers from Humboldt, Tennessee, he's committed to Georgia. He's on the Ole Miss campus today, Thursday, as we record this. You know, and you can tell by the quality of prospects. You know, we used to joke, I guess, in the industry all the time that, you know, when Hugh Freeze would have a camp out at Ole Miss, it was kind of like the Under Armour All-American game with all these guys out there, Robert Kimdichie and Laquan Treadwell, people such as that. Maybe I should say the Army game, the old Army game. But it's back to that level of recruiting. And, you know, when you're talking about how Ole Miss is doing, this is a new era. I don't think you can judge it in April or May or even September or October with the transfer portal. We saw what Ole Miss did in the portal last year, the number one portal class in America. And, you know, you can't discount those efforts as well, because really recruiting is a different game. I don't care what anybody says. There's not as much emphasis on high school recruiting as there was 5-6 years ago. I don't think anywhere. Because if your quarterback breaks his leg in the spring, you can go in the portal. If your running back transfers to Ohio State, you can go in the portal. And that makes all the difference in the world in terms of the quality product you'll put on the field in the fall. So judging the 25 class right now, I just don't think it's possible. Now, they're off to a great start. You know, and you've referenced Dylan Alfred a couple of times. You know, four-star wide receiver from Alabama, as you mentioned. He did grow up down in Goshen, Mississippi. But trained with former Rebel Mike Espy and ended up where we all thought he was going to be. So I'm glad to hear that. I'm glad to know that. I think you'll see Ole Miss do effectively well with their high school recruiting. And then we'll see what happens in the portal come December.
One thing we talked about, I guess, a couple of months ago was not only the synergy with the players, a number of them being new players, but with the coaching staff. Everything that you've seen, I know you've covered practice as much as Lane has allowed it. What have you seen with this coaching staff, at least from people you've talked to and then what you've seen personally about this coaching staff, the synergy together? Obviously, Charlie Weiss Jr. is offensive coordinator and Pete Golding is defensive coordinator, and then a number of new faces.
Yeah, they're having fun. I think that's the number one thing that jumps out. But maybe more importantly, every prospect I talk to who has attended an Ole Miss practice, that's one of the first things they say. They're having fun out there. And, you know, I think that's a trademark of Lane Kiffin's program. Everybody has fun. And I also think that's important to these football players. Number one is winning. Number two is having fun. And, you know, I can tell you, you know, when you're losing, it's not fun. Winning makes it fun. And that's the number one thing. I think they've come together fine. I mean, and I was talking to somebody the other day, a rival media member, if you will, about the Ole Miss defensive staff. And you know, you look around and you've got three noted defensive coordinators on the staff. You've got Pete Golding. It's his defense. He's in charge. You got Brian Brown, who played here, was a great D coordinator at Louisville and Cincinnati. And you got Zach Arnett, who at one time was one of the most revered D coordinators in the SEC before he got made into the head coach at Mississippi State. I mean, the brains inside the defensive room are absolutely incredible. And you got to think those three guys and all the support staff they have, Randall Joyner, everybody else, they just about can hatch a plan to, if not stop, slow down just about anybody they play. Because of why? The transfer portal. All of a sudden, Ole Miss has depth on the defensive line. And I'm talking about quality, rotational depth. Ole Miss has promise in the linebacker core, being led by Pooh Paul, the transfer from Arkansas. And then the secondary, well, look how Pete put it together last year. He's putting the same kind of secondary together this year, only this year's team, I think, is going to have a very viable answer to the ground game and the pass rush. So, I mean, I love what I'm seeing. I like everything I'm seeing right now.
Let's talk about spring practice for a moment. Once again, I don't know. I mean, I expect a huge crowd just because Ole Miss is playing Mississippi State in baseball. Obviously, the Rebel baseball team is down, but still playing Mississippi State, an opportunity to see the Rebels play. I expect a nice crowd on Saturday for the Grove Bowl games. What have you seen this spring that this kind of jumped out at you? I've asked you that question before, but I get asked that question a lot, and nobody covers practice more than you do. So I don't know if it's players. I don't know if it's cohesiveness. I don't know if it's enthusiasm. What have you seen in your opportunities of viewing practice for spring practice this year that you kind of filed away and thought, that's something to remember?
Yeah, I'll tell you, my biggest observation hasn't come from practice. It's come from bumping into guys uptown and having personal one-on-one conversations with them. I ran into Jeremy James the other night at Kroger. And Jeremy and I are talking, and it's the look in their eyes. It's the realization that they know they're in it to win it all this year. And wherever you run into Ole Miss players, excuse me, and talk to them, that's what I carry from that is, you know, all the fans have great expectations. These players have those same expectations, and they're taking it very seriously. Now, I know we're likely looking at a comedy playing out Saturday at the Grove Bowl. You know, we really, none of us really know what to expect. But these players, and they're veteran players, they know what their job is, and I think they've grasped that. You know, Lane can tweet out rat poison all he wants, but between now and kickoff, there really isn't going to be anything but positive things said about this Ole Miss football team. And, you know, to me, you have to embrace that. And I think the players have embraced it.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people now will enjoy Saturday's Grobo games. But I think more than anything, everybody will kind of turn to the portal in a couple of days and see what happens. You already talked about Henry Parrish Jr. We've said all along, we believe he'll enter the portal and transfer from Miami to Ole Miss. Still, though, that running back room is definitely been the room that everyone's kind of circled because of the injury prone that Ulysses Bentley has been. And then we'll see about Riscano. He's not, you know, had enough carries for us to really deem if he could be a number one or a number two back. We know Henry Parrish can. So it'll be fun to see. I mean, there's a story now about a couple of transfers or people that have entered the portal that could possibly come to Ole Miss that you've written. So I encourage everybody to go to Rebs247.com. That's, of course, Inside the Rebels, an affiliate of 24/7 Sports, and a ton of recruiting information and everything you need from there. Also, Tyler Comas has written a nice piece about what to expect on Saturday, everything that we know that we're going to be able to see. I think there are going to be a lot of surprises. And then everything from Joey Chestnut, the Nathan's Hot Dog Eating Champion. Yeah, you heard that correct. He'll be on campus in some capacity. I don't know.
I got to stop you there.
Yeah.
I mean, is Lane going to challenge him to a hot dog eating contest? What's going on with Joey Chestnut?
We didn't get a lot of information. And I don't know if Joey's going to be on the sideline, you know, just eating nonstop. I don't know if we're going to stop the game and there's going to be a contest between Joey and someone else. I am genuinely interested to see how they play in to the Grobo games with Joey Chestnut, who affectionately has the Twitter handle Joey Jaws. So I'm not sure how that's going to play in. I guess I'm more intrigued about, is this going to be just a ridiculous Saturday, or we're going to get some type of context of some sort? I think it's going to be a lot of craziness. So, but yeah, Joey Chestnut will be on campus on Saturday.
I don't get that. Ole Miss has the best marketing people in the world, and Joey Chestnut may be a hit. But generally speaking, when those hot dog eating contests are on ESPN, I flip the channel. Let's see what he does. What are the hot dogs called at Ole Miss? Are they called like victory dogs or something like that?
I mean, honestly don't know. Back
in our day at Delta State, they called them lucky dogs.
They did. That's to this day, I still call them lucky dogs.
Yeah.
To this day.
I don't even know if we have a name for the hot dogs.
I don't think they are. Here. They need to be called something.
I just saying kudos to the Ole Miss marketing department. You know, where is the hot dog sponsorship for this game? You know, why isn't Nathan's putting this game on?
Oscar Mayer Wiener Mobile could be in the end zone.
That may be that would probably be an attraction. I'd go look at that. I don't know, Brad. I mean, Joey Chestnut?
It just came out of left field. And Lane said that one of the media members asked him, what in the world? I mean, why Joey Chestnut? He says, I just direct message him and said if he'd like to come. I mean, is Lane sitting around watching Netflix and think, I think Joey Chestnut needs to come to our spring football game. Let me message him. Of all people, was he watching a replay of the hot dog eating competition? How does that come about?
Brad, I don't know. Saturday,
how he decided that Joey Chestnut needed to come to Ole Miss. I think I'm going to ask him that. I may get thrown out, and he may look at me weird, but I think I'm going to ask that question in the press conference.
Well, sooner or later, the internet will start the rumor that Joey Chestnut was a former Ole Miss quarterback great tore his ACL in his freshman year and didn't reach his potential, so thus he turned to hot dogs. But I don't know. I mean, maybe he's going to give a demonstration, eat 50 hot dogs in 5 minutes. I don't know. I had no idea. But that's what you have. You've got Juice the Dog and Joey Chestnut, the hot dog man.
If that loud man with the plastic hat shows up and starts screaming, you know, the guy on the hot dog eating, well, you said he didn't watch it.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But
yeah,
if he shows up and starts screaming, we're going to go full bananas.
I'd have put my money on a drunk, chair-throwing Morgan Wallen than Joey Chestnut.
Who will be in Oxford in a couple of weeks if he can get out of keep from going to jail.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm being facetious here, but Lord have mercy. We've got 20 quart coolers in the end zone at the spring game. We're bringing Morgan Wallen in to play at the vault. I guess beer is here, man. That's all I can say.
A couple of non-Ole Miss notes real quick. It appears that Scott Drew is going to stay at Baylor. So, you know, we haven't talked about this because it hasn't really involved Ole Miss other than Chris Beard was courted by the University of Arkansas. From everything we've heard, turned it down. And Keith Carter and the Grove Collective did a great job of securing Chris Beard. So they hired John Calipari from Kentucky, which, you know, for whatever reason, he's now at Kentucky. Surprised me. Now they're saying that Scott Drew has turned it down. Where in the world does Kentucky go now? They've been turned down by so many people. I don't know where AD Mitch Barnhart goes.
I don't know. Maybe basketball coaches are smarter than football coaches because, lots of coaches wanted to be Nick Saban's successor. Not many want to be Calipari's successor at Kentucky with the expectations they have. And Cal has fallen short of meeting those expectations, especially the last couple of years. But no idea. I don't know. All I know is Chris Beard is staying in Oxford. And you know, you get back to the whole Arkansas wanting him and failing to get him. It was the same thing with Lane Kiffin. And, you know, on the outside looking in, everybody goes, Arkansas, man, they've got to have a ton of money. Walmart is right there in Bentonville. But everybody I talk to in Arkansas tells me the Walton family has chosen Missouri as their primary benefactor. And now there are still a lot of other industries over there, J.B. Hunt Trucking, Tyson Foods. A lot of people in Arkansas with a lot of money, but they don't have it together. And the reason I bring that up is that we, Ole Miss, we do have it together in large part to having former Rebel football standout Walker Jones at the head of the Grove Collective. And, you know, we don't lose monetary contests as much as the rest of the SEC likes to believe we do. So, you know, kudos to Walker and the job he's doing. And the job Rebel Nation is doing because everybody has jumped in. And it takes everybody to have the winning teams that we all desperately want. And, you know, we've seen it work with football. We're seeing it work with basketball. Both basketballs, men's and women's. And, you know, we gotta make our way to the diamond sports as well while maintaining the success level of the sports aforementioned.
By the way, also news breaking this morning, O.J. Simpson has passed away due to cancer. Yeah. And so I think he was in his early 70s maybe. But, you know, just – something else in the sports world that's happening.
You know,
has passed away.
Brad, I always liked OJ all the way up until the killings. And, you know, because he was a great running back for the Buffalo Bills after his career at USC, won the Heisman there. And then turned to film and movies and, man, I loved him in all the Naked Gun movies.
He was really funny.
I loved those movies. He was funny. And, you know, just such a tragic turn of events for his life. And, you know. So I'm partially sad to see him move on.
Succumb to cancer. OJ Simpson is gone. So grateful for our sponsor today, College Corner Store. David, I don't know if you know, they had a huge sale over the weekend, and Scott, I'm sure, sold a ton. It was a great opportunity. A lot of things were half price, and it was a great opportunity to get some of those quarter zips that you like. And I know they sold a ton. They'll have another sale coming up, but you want to stay tuned to the College Corner Store, their website, and, of course, their brick-and-mortar store in Oxford off of Sisk Avenue, across from the elementary school there, right past the Wendy's on the left. David, you want to talk about – yes, sir.
Yeah, well, speaking of which, my wife went out there and bought me – and I've always wanted one of these. I've never purchased one. She went out there and bought me a St. Patrick's Day green baseball hat.
Yeah. Cap.
So I was I partook in the half price sale.
Yeah, a lot of stuff was on sale, and Scott shot me a message and said, "Hey, we're about to blow it up," and they absolutely did. And so very grateful for our sponsorship. It's doing very well with our friends over at the College Corner Store. David, baseball this weekend, the Rebels swept on the road against the best team in college baseball, the Arkansas Razorbacks. They've got Mississippi State coming in, and they really need to win a couple of games for the Bulldogs.
Yeah, we won't mention any names here, but we brought up Joey Chestnut being at the spring game. It's looking like there could be a very special guest at the baseball series. I'll leave it at that. You know what I'm talking about.
I do.
but we'll leave that alone.
So the Rebels and the Bulldogs, it'll start on Friday night. Saturday is the game that everybody's kind of circled. Of course, the Grobo games are going to happen at 3 p.m. After that, everyone will walk over to the stadium. But if you're going to do that, you're going to have to buy a standing room ticket because the chairbacks are sold out. So it'll be a monster crowd. And, David, you really hope, you know, if we put our fan hat on here, the Rebels can find whatever they're missing and play well against the Bulldogs and at least, you know, play well. I'm not saying they need to win all the games, but I'd love to see the guys play well. They pitched it pretty well. Too many errors, too many fast balls, and just not enough timely hitting.
Yeah, and I want to correct you on one thing. Not everybody will be walking to the baseball stadium. Some of these guys and girls will be stumbling to the baseball stadium after sitting out in the sun for 3 hours and drinking. But they'll go to the baseball stadium and drink some more. So festive night in Oxford, very important series for Ole Miss. And, you know, the first thing you talk about whenever there's a state Ole Miss matchup in anything is state pride. And they need to win this series. You know, it's not going to be easy based off the previous results we've seen this year, but you know, here it is. And Ole Miss needs to take 2 of 3 from Mississippi State. I don't think anything else is acceptable. We need to win a series from the Bulldogs.
And we haven't talked about the transfer portal in regards to basketball, but Jared Redding does a great job covering hoops for us at Inside the Rebels. There is a thread right now pinned at the top of the board at reps247.com about all the players that Ole Miss is or could be interested in. That's going to be an interesting move. You know, we talked about Arkansas a little bit ago. John Calipari in his introductory press conference says, "I just met the team. There's not any players left." So yeah. The portal of basketball is going to be, if not wilder, than the portal for football.
Yeah, and then Calipari tweeted something out, a picture of his home office this morning, and he had a photo of Nolan Richardson above his desk, and he says it's always been there. I wonder if it's always been there, but in any event, he's embracing the Hogs. They're going to embrace him. They're going to be a tough out moving forward, period. And anybody who's thinking otherwise, well, I got some oceanfront property in Lafayette County I'll sell you. But, you know, they're going to be pretty good and pretty fast.
Real quick, we were talking about baseball a moment ago. Ole Miss's strength of schedule is number 3. That's why their RPI is so high. They're like in the 20s. Even though their record is not good and they haven't been playing well as of late, they have a really good RPI because of their record. The good news, if you look at it from a glass half full, is the back half of the schedule eases up tremendously for Ole Miss. So if they can figure some things out this weekend, then you've got Georgia, and that's an opportunity to continue to get better. If you're looking at it with red and blue glasses, there's an opportunity to kind of right the ship, if you will.
We look at everything through red and blue glasses, right?
Yeah, I guess we do.
So, I guess we do.
Speaking of red and blue glasses, David, I need to ask you this. Softball kind of struggling as of late. You've kept a close eye on that program. What do they need to do to turn this thing around?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked me that, because I've got something to say. You know, a lot of people felt like Mike Smith was run out of town unwarranted. And, you know, maybe he was. But I'm going to say this. I've been watching this program be on the launching pad with its potential ever since, 2014? I think Mike first took them to the NCAA tournament. I may be wrong in my year. But they've been building ever since. And, you know, Jamie Traxel got this job in year one of the in the midst of the pandemic. And so that was a difficult body of water to navigate. But I don't know what's happening other than we do not have a dominant pitcher. And, you know, I don't think we could hit a snake in the bottom of the boat. And that gets back to recruiting. And we have to recruit at the same level, if not better, than other schools in this conference. And until we do that, we're going to always beat the non-conference opponents, except we lost to Tennessee Martin last week. And there are going to be flashes of this being a pretty good program, but when it comes down to it, you know, we're just not an SEC compatible program. We've lost 9 in a row, extremely disappointing. And all of the 9 losses have come after taking 2 of 3 from then number 2 ranked LSU on the road. So, I'm a little perplexed. This is the first year for the assistant coaches on Jamie's staff. And Riker Chason and Katie Rykovich left over the offseason. I just don't know. And I hear people say, there's going to be magic in this new facility we're building. Have you looked around at the SEC? Everybody has big, beautiful softball facilities. So I personally think the construction of a new facility is a wash.
Well,
it's not going to be any better than what they have in Fayetteville. It's not going to be any better than what's in Baton Rouge. It's not going to be any better than what they have in Starkville.
They've got Western Kentucky this weekend, a non-conference weekend slate, and then it cranks up against Texas A&M the following week in College Station. It's not going to get any easier. He's David Johnson. I'm Brad Logan. We'll talk to you soon. Enjoy the Grove Bowl games. As always, we're grateful for our sponsor, the College Corner Store, located right off of Sisk Avenue, right past the Wendy's on the left and across from the elementary school. As we told you, a huge sale this past weekend. You never know, they might have a couple of items left just for you. Be sure and tell them you heard about it on the Red and Blue Crew podcast. We appreciate that. Also, if you could subscribe, rate, and review however you listen to us, whether it be on YouTube, Google Play, iTunes, Spotify, or you listen just straight online, subscribe. We appreciate it. And you guys have helped us grow this podcast more than we could ever imagine, and you are because of that. We've got a huge football season upcoming, with a lot of news coming, and by the way, of sponsorships, and we're excited that we can be a part of your podcast family. If you'd like to advertise on the program, just shoot us a direct message at Rebels247 or at Brad Logan COTE. We'd love to hook you up. And as always, we appreciate you, the listener. and we'll talk to you next week. We break down all of the Grove Bowl games, and hopefully we'll be breaking down an Ole Miss series win over Mississippi State right here on the Red and Blue Crew Podcast.
Corner is headed to Oxford. Stop by their new location in the Oxford Commons off Sisk Avenue. They'll have 4,000 square feet of Rebel gear ready for your trip to the Grove. On your next trip to Oxford, stop by the College Corner or our other great locations in Ridgeland and Flowood. Hats, shirts, polos, pullovers, sweats, t-shirts. College Corner has it all. And as always, you can visit us online at collegecornerstore.com. That's collegecornerstore.com. The College Corner, where your game day apparel meets.
It is a place which exerts an extraordinary pull on all who have walked its hallowed ground. Thousands come each year, and yet no one ever really leaves. Ole Miss is for life, a major university with the familiar intimacy of family. Friendships that are more than friendships, moments that are more than moments. An autumn celebration on a Saturday afternoon in the Grove. Contests waged and triumphs savored. With our largest freshman class, soaring honors college, national reputation for academics and research, our pride is overflowing. Today, more than ever, for all who have ever called this magical place home, you never leave Ole Miss.
You've been listening to the Red and Blue Crew Podcast with your hosts, David Johnson and Brad Logan, the source for all Ole Miss sports news, rumors, and innuendo. From the Inside the Rebels studios, join us next time right here on the Red and Blue Crew Podcast.